What a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms, leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to day two of DCC Connect. I hope you're getting connected with the Lord. I was blessed yesterday. I got some insight into the word of the Lord as Pastor Petro was sharing yesterday, and it's a blessing. And if you're not here yesterday, praise God you're here today. Because it's going to be better. Right. Before we start, let's all rise and have a prayer. And we'll start. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we want to thank you for bringing us again to your presence. The Bible says in your presence there is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. It says that all cry, tears, pain, grief, whatever that a person might be going through, we can lay them at your feet, and at that point take your praise and depart with a new heart, a new life, a new experience. So tonight we want to have another experience with you. Open our hearts to see how deep your love is towards us. Our topic today is another intriguing one. I believe, Lord, you've prepared Pastor Petros, and you're going to speak to each and every one of us as you've desired. For those who are still on their way, we ask, oh God, that you bring them in safely, and you bless and take all glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Right, so I want to take this time to welcome you all. If you just come in and you need some small light things to munch, there's still some few things that we can share outside at the gate. Get some little refreshment and water, drink, and relax in the Lord's presence. So tonight, yesterday we spoke about the message was, what is love? Today the topic will be, for God so loved. And I am just waiting to be blasted or to be blessed, whichever way you want. I feel excited, to be honest. I'm not sure, I don't know about you, but there are so many insightful things I picked up yesterday, and I'm looking for that. I was just busy putting them on my phone as is speaking them, because I can't wait to just screenshot. Things I'm hearing, also putting down, because you can't screenshot what you're hearing. It's a blessing for us all. Before we go on, I want to invite us to have some praise worship, and this time I will invite Mr. Pider for us to go into the songs of praise.
Good evening, church. Amen. We will sing two hymns, hymn 245, More About Jesus. So I wasn't supposed to be standing here alone, but I guess the people I requested got busy. So if you feel the Holy Spirit moving you, and if you are a chorister or a singer, feel free to come up front. Two, three people will be fine. All right. More About Jesus. Am I just going to sing without the pianist? I guess. All right. Let's sing. Let's go ahead. More about Jesus I would know. More of his grace to others show. More of his saving fullness see. More of his love who died for me. More about Jesus. More about Jesus. More of his saving fullness see. More of his love who died for me. More about Jesus let me learn. More of his hope. Jesus, more about Jesus. More about Jesus in his word, holding communion with my Lord, hearing his voice in every line, making each faithful saying mine. More about Jesus, more about Jesus on his throne, riches and glory all his own, more of his kingdom sure increase, more of his coming Prince of Peace, more about Jesus, Hymn 185, Jesus is all the world to me. And I hope we'll sing with that conviction that Jesus is the world to us. Amen?
Amen.
You know, all right, the problem with being used as a pianist, you kind of wait for them. So now, back to the old days. Jesus is all the world to me, my joy, my joy, my all. He is my strength from day to day. Without him I would fall. When I am sad, to him I go. No other one can cheer me so. When I am sad, he makes me glad. He is my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, my friend in trials sore. I go to him for blessings, and he gives them all. Sunshine and the rain.
He sends the harvest golden grain.
Sunshine and rain, harvest of grain. He's my friend. Jesus is all the world to me, and true to him I'll be. Following him, I know I'm right. He watches all me day and night. Following him, thank you for that lovely singing.
God is good. Amen. Now it's time for our prayer. We are all going to break out in two to three people. Let's all meet up in prayer. So let's start. Wherever possible, shall we all kneel down for prayer? to our most kind and gracious loving Father, what above. Father God, we come before your throne of mercy this evening. Lord, we are here as your children. We are here, Lord, because you are our Father. We have no one to call upon. You said, call upon me, I'll be there. Lord, we are gathered here to seek your face, to seek your name, to seek your presence. Father God, we want to ask for forgiveness of sins. Many of us, we have sinned against you in so many ways. The way we talk, our motives, our actions, our characters, Lord, are not good. We are seeking your face this evening, that Lord, the blood that spilled on Calvary, may it cleanse us tonight from all unrighteousness, so that our prayer may be a sweet-smelling incense, Lord, at the throne of mercy. Jehovah, we came here, Lord, because we are coming from different spheres of life. Many are depressed, many are sick, but Lord, here is the hospital that we find you. We come here, Lord, because we know you said in your word in Psalms 50:15, call upon me in the day of trouble and I'll deliver you. Lord, some of us here, we are facing a lot of challenges. Some, Lord, the visas are ending. They don't have money. Some, they don't even know where they are going to be sleeping tonight. Some, they don't even know what to put on the table for their kids. Some, Lord, are faced with sickness, money to pay for hospital bills and so many things. Lord, with all these challenges, with all these trials, you just tell us in Proverbs, like, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all thy ways, seek the Lord, for he will direct your paths. Lord, many of us, we are seeking you tonight that you may direct our paths. We don't know where to go. Like Daniel, when he was cast into the den of lions, he didn't know what to do, but all he did, he just called upon you. We are here, Lord, praising your name, as you said in Psalms. David says, I will lift up mine eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord. Father God, we thank you because you are a helper in times of need. We thank you, Lord, because you've been our pillar of strength in all the situations and all the spheres of life that we have been coming through. Jehovah, with all the different things that we have, some we are coming unto you tonight with praises. Some have got new contracts to sign, new jobs to start. Oh Lord, all this we give glory, praise to your name. Above all, we want to thank you, Lord, for being our creator. You have sustained us up to this day. We have so many people who died on COVID and so many things. But Lord, perhaps tonight is just my only chance to listen to your word. May you speak to us tonight. May you open our hearts, Lord, so that we may hear your word. Lord, we may seek your word. You said in Psalms 37, take delight in the Lord. He will give you the desires of your heart. When we take delight, when we take time to come and seek your face, Lord, you said you will hear us, Lord. We want to thank you, for you said in your word, we are not supposed to be anxious about anything. But in every situation, we are supposed to give thanks. Also, by prayer and petition, we need to present our request unto you. Father God, we are here as your children, requesting and presenting our request unto you. Some of our prayer requests are like secrets. We can't even say them in public. But you, Lord, you know our hearts. You even know the number of hairs in our head. You even engraved our names in the palms of your hands. Lord, I present each and every individual that's kneeling here, seeking your face, seeking your grace at this moment. Now we are praying. We are about to hear and receive our spiritual food. Father God, may we be like the seed that fell on the fertile ground. Our hearts, may they be open to your word. When we receive this word, may it not only end on the door, but may we change our characters, our attitude. Mold us, O Lord. You said in your word, you are the potter and we are the clay. Father God, I'm declaring tonight that you may mold us. Break us, Lord. Some of us, we have pride. Break us, Lord. Some of us, we are going through things that even to be spoken of, it's unheard of. Break us, O Lord. We are here to meet you, Father God. May you break us and mold us to be vessels that are fit for your salvation. When your holy angel is coming down, Jehovah, pouring blessings, oh, Father God, may we be found fit for the blessings of salvation. Now we want to present our speaker into your hands. Lord, whatever he's going to say, as you did to Jeremiah, as you did to Aaron and Moses, they didn't know what to say to your children, but you said to them, you go before them. You be on their lips, Lord. May you be on his lips. When he speaks, may we not hear him, but may we hear your word speaking unto us. Soon we are going to be going back to our different places. May we never go back the same. Above all, Lord, may we know that we are waiting for the second coming of Jesus Christ. May we be ready, oh Lord, may we not be found on the other side. But may we be the ones saying, Lord, we are here, we've been waiting for you, giving praise and honor to the Lord. I pray also for the other church members that are not here, Lord, bless them in a mighty way. We pray for the whole program to be surrounded with your angels. We pray and ask all this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ and Savior. Amen.
Good evening. There is power in prayer. Amen. If you come to the Lord with your open heart, your sincere heart, the Lord will hear and the Lord will act. My Bible says, seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open to you. And call, somebody is going to answer. So may God bless you. May God bless you and may God bless us as we come to him in prayer. I have a few books that I want to read my hands off. So I will ask a few questions. Now the first question is very, very simple. Who was here yesterday? And you're here again today. Okay, good. For you there is nothing. Now I want to see if there is anybody else who is here tonight. You were not here yesterday. So tonight's your first night. Okay, we have a few people. I think my books might be finished now. Can I get somebody to bring me some more books from the back? Rion, can you please help me? Keep your hand up. If you're here for the first time tonight, I have my sister here. Welcome. God bless you. Keep your hand up, and we want to give you a little gift. Now, this book is a blessing. I think I told you yesterday, at the beginning of every year, I read this book. Every January, at the beginning of the year, I read this book. It's a very short book, but a powerful book. So make sure that you read it at least once. All right, very good. Now, for those of you who were here yesterday, I want to ask you a few questions. Because, you know, Pastor Petras came from very long. So if you hear, I hope you remember what you hear. So I will ask a few questions, and if you know the answer, just shoot your hand up. And, well, you have to tell us the answer to the question. So let's see. There is another mic here. Okay, there we go. Turn it on, please. These questions are very simple, okay? So just shoot your hand up and let's give it a try. So what is love? There's a hand here. Oh, who was first? There? Sorry, he's the one checking. What is love?
Well, us Christians, we would say that God is love.
Amen, amen. Do you agree with that? Okay, am I allowed to give him a little book so he can either read it or give it to somebody? Okay, good. Thanks a lot. Let's do the next question. The next question is, what is the meaning of the word Yahid? You remember? Yahid. There was a hand there. Well, she went down. There is a bolder hand here.
It's okay. Yahid, one only alone.
Uh-huh. Pastor, do you agree? Yes. So Yahid is a Hebrew word.
Oneness.
Good. Yahid means one, but one alone, one only thing. Good. Thank you. I have another question. Now, there was another word, a similar word, and that word was Echad. What's the meaning of Echad? Do you agree, Pastor? Yes. Oneness? Okay. Now, to make it a little bit more difficult, because this is too easy. Huh? Do you remember the example that he gave for that oneness? He mentioned a few things, but he made an emphasis on one example. Can somebody remember? My sister here has to. What is it?
He gave an example, like a family, when, let me say, your father is about to die, he can say, I want you to live as one. You're seven brothers, but he says you should live as one. Yeah.
Good, good, good. Very good, very good. He also said about husband and wife. He also said about the church. And, you know, all of these are composite units. There is more than one, but they become one. Like God said to the man and the woman, they shall become one flesh. Do you want some more questions? Or are we done? All right, let's see. What do you call someone who loves himself and himself only? Selfish. Okay, this was just trial question, okay? Yeah, because we said God is love, right? The Bible says God is love. But if God is one alone only by himself, before he created angels, before he created people, before he created anything else, who was he loving? So that's why the Christian understanding is that you have God, you have the Word, and you have the Spirit. So there is this love. You remember the word? This love party. Good. I have another question here. And maybe this is a bit tricky. This question is a bit hard. I hope you remember. What does it mean that we are created in the image of God? Pastor mentioned two things. What does it mean that we are created in the image of God? This is like college level question. He wants to answer. This is not fair. Anyone wants to give it a shot? He said two things. We are created in the image of God because of two things. Anybody remembers? Yes, brother.
We are one in blood.
We are one.
In blood.
Okay. That's one thing. We are one. We are one in what?
Blood.
In blood. Okay. We are one. Okay. That's one of the things that he said, because we are one. But he said something else. What's the second thing?
He spoke about husband and wife being one flesh together.
Uh-huh.
He spoke in those terms.
Yes. So that's the same element about the oneness. We are created in the image of God because we are many, but we are one. There was something else. Yes. Anushit.
Yeah, he spoke about we are created in the same image like him, which means we are in the same form like him.
Amen, amen, amen. We are all catching the element of oneness. Let's see if we get the other part.
Okay. What it means to be created in God's image? It because we are created through the Word. Through the Word we are created. So without Him, nothing was made. Meaning we were made through Jesus. So we are in the image of Him, God.
Amen, amen. Now you ruined my next question, because I was going to ask you who created us. To finish this question, he said we are created in the image of God because of two things. One is that we have this oneness. Out of many, there is oneness. The other one is that we were created to love. We were created to love. Huh? Yeah, so we were created in oneness and for the purpose of loving, not just loving ourselves, but loving others. Now, let me see, because now Anoshet killed my question. Do I have any more questions here? No? Finished. Because this one is too easy. Should I ask this? This is way too easy. Okay, no, this will be a shouting contest. Who is the Word of God? Jesus, amen. For those who were not here yesterday, you can go to our YouTube channel and you can see the message. We are not able to live stream as it is happening, but we are putting in after. So if you go to the, what's the name of our YouTube channel? DCC Media? If you search for DCC Media or Dubai Central Adventist Church on YouTube, you will find our channel and you can see the messages there. May God bless you. I pray that you pay attention to the message tonight, and tomorrow I'll have some more interesting questions for you. God bless.
All right, let's have our theme song. I'll invite Stepida again for the theme song as we all rise for the song.
Shall we rise? It's a contemporary song, so feel free to sing along. You won't find it in your hymn books.
Let my heart be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see.
Repeat again.
Lord.
You. Amen. You may be seated.
Just to introduce our speaker tonight, Pastor Petrus Bahadur is the director for the Adventist Muslim Relations at the General Conference. And he's been here before. I remember very well my dad met you. Yeah. And he's been very blessed. I remember he still talks about some few people. So tonight we want to welcome Pastor Petrus and pray that the Lord will bless the congregation by his words. Pastor Petrus.
Savior's great love in coming from heaven above to die on a tree for a sinner like me. I am sure that he loves even me. I am sure that he loves even me. I am sure that he loves even me. And his love is so sweet, makes my joy so complete. When I think how he loves even me, when I think of the turns on his brow, seems as if I can see Jesus now. As he suffered for me, that my soul might be free, I am sure that he loves even me. I am sure that he loves even me. I am sure that he loves even me. And his love is so sweet, make my joy so complete. When I think he loves even me. ungrateful I've been. My vow I renew to be faithful and true. I am sure that He loves even me. Loves even me. I am sure that He loves even me, and His love is so sweet, make my joy so complete. When I think how He loves even me, when I think how He loves even me.
Thank you. That was a song well connected to the sermon this evening. I'll probably tell you what's going to be tomorrow's text, topic, so that the song is connected as well. This was wonderful. I loved it, because this is exactly what I'm going to be talking about today, about Jesus' love. Anyway, yesterday we talked about what? God is. What? God is love. And we defined it in three steps. Step number one was, God is love proves through Trinity. And God is one proves through Trinity. There is no other way to show that Trinity is right except to say that He loves in Trinity. And to show that He's one, and the oneness is more than one person, not just by Himself. Second thing we said was, that when Jesus came into the world, or rather when humans were created first, and then of course Jesus came later, when humans were created, God says what? May they love one another, husband and wife, and may they be one. Same thing that God is exactly in human beings. And then Jesus comes into the world, and that's what we're going to be seeing today. Jesus then exemplifies that love on the highest degree, and Jesus manifests God's oneness to the world, that God, the Father, and Jesus, the Son on earth, are one. And then He turns around by the end of the time when He's about to be crucified, and He says, may they be one, and may they love each other, one another. So then we are seeing over and over again the same recurrence of the same theme. What's the theme? God is one, God is love. And because God is one, because God is love, Trinity can only be proven by this. Otherwise, you can't prove one single God with love. And you can't show the oneness of God if God is just alone. Are you with me? So only Trinity makes sense. Are you with me? Only Trinity makes sense. So Christians who are now going on the route of Unitarianism, meaning there is only one single God, they are going on a path that the Bible never showed. They're going because they're trying to cognitively understand according to their mind. They will not be able to understand, because we have to believe what the Bible says, not what we think makes sense. Are you with me? Even if it doesn't make sense, God knows what is best. Okay, good. So I think we just recapped yesterday's sermon, and now we move on to our today's sermon. Because let me then give you, which I didn't want to, every night I wanted to surprise you with a new set of things, but tonight I'm going to tell you what's coming ahead so that you can be excited, because I'm so excited, because I've never preached on love for a long, long time. But then when I started seeing these things, and then Pastor Andy says, come and do a evangelistic, I said, oh, I already have four series of sermons I'm going to preach. I know exactly what I'm going to be saying. Number one, God is love. That's the definition of love. That's the definition of God. Today, I'm going to show how God showed His love. Are you with me? Yesterday was not about how God shows love. Yesterday was about who God is. And we said God is love. Today we're saying that God exemplifies his love, manifests his love through a certain action. And we're going to see that action of his love. Tomorrow, I'm going to preach, now moving on, defining God and showing that God has loved us. Then what's the next theme? We need to love each other. Are you with me? Because God has loved us, and because he has shown us his love through Jesus' sacrifice on the cross, now we move to loving one another. Because that's the only sensible thing to happen in the Bible. And we've seen that as Jesus gives a last commandment, he says, a new commandment I give unto you, love one another. Which means he's not giving a new commandment. This is billions and billions of years ago. That's exactly what he's been telling. And now he's saying, I give you a new commandment, meaning if you didn't understand it before, understand it now. That's what he means. Then on Sabbath, I am so excited. I'm going to be telling you a story of Jesus telling us a story that tells us what God's love is and what is that party that is going on, because God is waiting for people to come and then he's going to celebrate. The Bible says when one sinner comes to Father, then angels in heaven celebrate. There's a party that goes on every time a sinner comes back to the Father. But there was a sinner that came back. His name is Prodigal Son. And I'm going to tell you that story because that's the favorite story now. I have never preached on that sermon. Only 2-3 weeks ago I preached. My thing is I don't preach on sermons that others preach on. I try to speak something new. So when Prodigal Son, because I heard so many sermons on Prodigal Son, not once in my 20 years of ministry did I ever speak on Prodigal Son. But then I was captivated by this love that I see in the Father. I was captivated how the Father throws a party to this wayward, prodigal, lavishing, throwing, you know, a party for a person who is evil, sinful, lost, and he throws. And that's where I see the true example of God's love for you and me, because we are all prodigals. So on Sabbath, I want to end with that. So are you excited? That's what we're going to be dealing with in the next 2 days we have. Today then, the Holy Spirit takes over. I'm so happy that you prayed for me. Today I was not feeling well. I was better yesterday, but today I was not feeling well. All day I was not. 5 minutes ago I was so unwell, and I was saying, man, what's going to happen today? But I'm perfect. Are you with me? Because Holy Spirit does it over and over and over again. I knew it. When I'll stand up, everything will be okay. Pastor Andy prayed for me, and I know I'll be okay. And you prayed for me, and I know I'll be perfectly fine. Okay, so today we're talking about for God so loved. We already know God is love, but for God so loved is our topic today. Okay, good. So I'm going to be playing with two screens here. One with this and one on my computer, because I don't want to look back every time. Are you with me? So we're talking about what? Unity in diversity. This is my whole sermon yesterday, basically. And I'm now recapping it in another way. Unity in diversity. Meaning, we think that unity implies the idea of conformity. Meaning, everything needs to fall in line with a certain norm. That's what we think is unity. Everything falls in line in a certain norm. No, not really. In reality, what we're saying is this, that unity does not reject the idea of diversity. And we can maintain the idea of differences in the boundary of unity. We can maintain the idea of differences in the boundary of unity. Unity does not imply that everything is in line with one norm, meaning everything is white or everything is black, everything is short or everything is tall. No. You can have short and tall, you can have black and white, you can have big and small, and you're all united. That is the beauty of God's oneness that we were talking about yesterday. In fact, God did a very interesting thing, that he made us all small, big, black, white, yellow, brown, everything he's made us. We are so different people. Why? Because he wants us to learn to live together as one. And if we can live together in this diversity, unitedly, then we are ready for the kingdom of heaven. In fact, I always try to understand what is one thing that will take me to heaven. That is, if I can learn to live with people that are so different, that are so unlike me, that I don't seem to like, and I can still love them, man, I'm ready for the kingdom of heaven. But if I am unable to even live up with my brother or sister who are so annoying, are you with me? My children always keep saying to me, Dad, you're so annoying. You know, when you get a certain age and the children are younger, they become adults, 20, 24, then we become very annoying because we are double their age, actually. But, you know, we can be annoying, but we can still love each other. We can be different, but we can still be united. We can be diverse, and we can still be united together. That's what we're looking at today. Are you with me? So unity in diversity. Well, this is also a recap of yesterday's message, okay? So that's what we had yesterday. So God had a plan to redeem the world. How did he want to redeem the world? We left yesterday at a point where God created human beings and gave it as a gift to the Son, meaning Jesus, the Word. And then he says to the Word, create them. And after he created them, what happened? They sinned. Are you with me? They became what? God's enemies. They became what? God's enemies and rebellious children. Amazing. And then now, God is not going to save them who are coming to him and forgiving, asking for forgiveness. No, he is going to save those people who are rebellious, who are evil, who are enemies of God. He is going to save them. Are you with me? This is why we need to understand the God of the Bible is a very different God than any other God of the world. This is why God of the Bible makes absolute sense, because he does not work in the same way that we work. So his desire is to bring them together in their diversity. He's not going to bring us together in the same norm. He's going to leave us where we are in our diversity, and yet he would want to bring us together as one. So then, he's going to unite us as one. Remember, this is now yesterday. But let's pick up the story now. How is God going to do this? He's going to do it through a man by the name of Abraham. Are you with me? Before this, he did it two times. First, he chose Adam, and then he chose Noah, and now he's going to choose last time Abraham. Adam failed, didn't work. Noah failed, didn't work. But now God doesn't care whether Abraham works or fails or doesn't fail. He is going to choose him, and he will accomplish through him his plan. And then God is not going to worry whether Abraham fulfills his side of the promise or not. God doesn't care. He's going to do it anyway. Are you with me? And that's the story we're picking up. Through Abraham now, he's going to accomplish his plan, which he made where? In the Garden of Eden. When we were still sinners, when we were still far away from God, God made a plan. And now he establishes that covenant through Abraham. And he says, through Abraham, I'm going to accomplish this plan. Okay? God is going to make a covenant between himself and Abraham. And if you remember the story, when he made the covenant, he put the animals on two sides, cut the animals, because that's the way they made covenant in those days. We don't make covenant like that. We don't kill animals and then go through the middle of the animals to say, if we don't keep our side of the covenant, me or you could be killed. That's what God was saying. If I don't fulfill my side of the covenant, I will put myself on the line. And Abraham, if you don't fulfill your side of the covenant, you will have to die. But actually, when God made that covenant, Abraham never walked through that. Only God walked through it. Meaning, Abraham, whether you do it or not, I will accomplish my side of the covenant. I remember many, many years ago in 1998, not many years ago, but a few years ago. In 1998, September 3, I promised to walk with the Lord. And over the course of time, many times I fell away, fell short of his glory, fell short of my commitment that I made to the Lord. Are you with me? But I have never, ever seen God not be with me. I used to have a disease by the name of hay fever. I don't know whether you know what hay fever is. I used to sneeze every day, every day, every day. You know, I used to sneeze. But on Friday, I started fasting. I said, Lord, tomorrow I'm going to be preaching. If I sneeze like what I do all the time, how can I preach the sermon tomorrow? So God, I'm fasting today so you can help me tomorrow so I can preach the sermon. In the 20 years of my preaching, not once on Sabbath did I ever sneeze. Even till today. I've never sneezed on Sabbath. Why? Because I've prayed on Friday and God takes care of me. But all other days, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, I used to sneeze all the time, sneeze. Because I had this sneezing problem, which didn't only come in June when there was pollen. But my hay fever is related to wind. So anytime there's wind, I get hay fever. And I used to sneeze all day. Like 300 times a day, meaning. So much. Until I lie down on the bed, I can't be well. But then I used to pray, God, please, tomorrow I'm going to... And my wife says to me, why don't you pray that God will take away this disease? I said, no. I don't want this disease to go away from me. I like it to stay. Because this is the only thing that keeps me on my knees. Because I don't have any other disease. This is the only disease I have. But now, of course, I've got two or three other diseases, so I can pray about those, you know. But at that time, that is about 20, 15 years ago, I only had a small little disease, hay fever. But this was not small, it was still big. So I used to pray for God to help me. God will always keep his side of the covenant. I'm telling you one thing. I've experienced it over and over and over again. I want to tell you that through Abraham, God makes a covenant. And God says to Abraham, I will fulfill my covenant. And then God gives the terms of the covenant, which were not limited to the Jewish nation. Are you with me? Through Abraham came what? The Jewish nation. But God is not going to limit his covenant to the Jewish nation. Look at what God says to him. God says that all the nations of the earth will be blessed through whom? Abraham. So Abraham is just... In the line of the covenant, Abraham is just a person through whom he's going to accomplish. Israel is just a nation whom God is going to choose so his blessings can be for the whole world. It's not just for Abraham. It's not just for Israel. Are you with me? So we're starting a story. Are you with me on the story tonight? We're starting the story of God's amazing love that God is now going to exemplify through Abraham and his people. So what are we talking about? Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and what? Israel. Okay? That's the chosen people of God. Chosen people of God, and they're going to accomplish God's plan. Israel will be the nation that will bless all other nations. But it's not going to happen. In Genesis 26, verse number 4, it says, I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven. This is Israel. This is Abraham. This is Isaac. This is Jacob. This is Israel. Are you with me? That's only that line. I will multiply your offspring as the stars of heaven and give you what? Land. Israel. In your offspring, all the nations will be blessed. Through whom? Through Abraham, through Isaac, through Jacob, and through Israel, the chosen nation of God. But as you can understand, many times when God gives us that opportunity, we become very proud. But God will use the nation of Israel to do what? To fulfill his promise. There are two things. Number one is the promise, and number two is covenant. The promise was made in Genesis 3:15. The covenant was made with Abraham. Are you with me? Promise was made in Genesis 3:15, but it took 2,000 years from Adam to Abraham before God reignited that covenant in Abraham. Okay, so then, we're not talking about physical blessing here. We're talking about spiritual blessing. Are you with me? Spiritual blessing in what sense? We're talking about the spiritual blessing that will come through the line of Israel. Are you with me? Through the line of Sarah, through the line of Jacob, through the line of Israel, through the line of David, through the line of Solomon, and through the line of Jesus. This is the spiritual blessing we're talking about. And this is the covenant that God is making with Abraham. That through your line, I will establish my covenant. But the promise was made where? In Genesis 3:15. So God is saying that I'm going to accomplish, because of love, God created man. And after sin, what happened? After sin, he did not let him die. Okay? But God provided what? A plan. Where? In the Garden of Eden. The plan was provided in the Garden of Eden. And that plan is, we see in Genesis 3:15. The plan was made for the rebellious people, rebellious children, which you and me, we are the rebellious children of God. We are enemies of God. We became the enemies of God when we went away from God. The human race became the enemies of God. So God chose Abraham. God chose Abraham and he says to him, bring your son on the altar. Are you with me? Remember the story? Everything that will happen in the life of Abraham, in the life of Israel, in the life in the Old Testament is exactly what will happen in the New Testament. Same thing. God says to Abraham, bring your son, put him on the altar here on Mount Moriah and kill him. And Abraham is willing to do that, but then God says, no, Abraham, you don't do it. Last week I was on Mount Moriah in Jerusalem. And I saw exactly where Abraham sacrificed his son or was about to sacrifice his son is exactly the place where Jesus was sacrificed. Are you with me? So then God is saying to Abraham, bring your son, but not your son. I will lay down my son. Are you with me? So that is the story. That is why we are saying Abraham's story is crucial in this line of understanding God's love. Because Abraham's story becomes only a symbol of what God is going to do in the future. So then, from Abraham, he chooses his son. Who is the son? Isaac. And then he chooses another son, Israel. And then he chooses another son, which is David. Then he chooses another son, which is Solomon. And then comes the son of God. So who is Abraham? He's the son of God. And then who is Isaac? The son of God. Really, God doesn't say to Abraham, you're the son of God. He says to Isaac's son, Isaac the son, that he is the son I will make a covenant with. And then he says to Israel, that you are my son, I make my covenant with you. Then he says to David, you are my son. And then he says to Solomon, you are my son, and I am your father. Meaning, son of God, in the lineage of Abraham, in the lineage of Isaac, in the lineage of Israel. So when the Bible presents Jesus as the Son of God, we Christians are wondering, how is he the Son? How did God make him a Son? No, it's just a symbol that you see in the Old Testament now is being fulfilled in the New Testament, a symbol. They were the sons of... So when God is saying begotten, he is not begetting Jesus. I've read so many books that explain how Jesus was begotten from God, how he was expelled out of God. You know, he was expelled out of God. He was generated out of God. He proceeded out of God. We spend so many books. We write so many, many, many books in order to explain how this all happened. But really, this is not what it's talking about. When the Bible is saying Son of God, it's simply saying God chooses a son, and then Jesus is fulfilling that sonship in the line of the Old Testament sonship covenant. Sonship is a covenant term. And then God says to Abraham, your son Isaac shall be the one. I will make my covenant through him. But Abraham says, listen, God, what about Ishmael? And God says, I will bless Ishmael as well, but my covenant shall be with Isaac. Are you with me? Because he is the son. When you think that there is going to be no son, I will give you a son through him, through you. Okay, so we're talking about this God's plan. God is going to use this nation. God is going to choose the family of Abraham, and promise that was made through him will be accomplished. How? Because they are the Jewish nation through whom God is going to do. But by the time Jesus comes on the line, you see, Israelites were brought into Israel from Egypt. They were brought. Oh, by the way, as I said, everything that happens to Israel is everything that will happen to Jesus. Everything that happens to Abraham will happen to Jesus. Everything that happens to Isaac and David and Solomon will be exemplified in the life of Jesus. Let's take the example for Israel, for instance. Israel went where? Egypt. Came out of where? Egypt. Okay? Then came where? To Israel. And then came through what? The water. Are you with me? To the sea. Jesus goes where when he was born after in Bethlehem? He goes to Egypt. Then Jesus comes from where? He comes back from Egypt. Then after that, Jesus does what? He goes through the water. He's baptized. Then after that, Jesus goes where? He goes to the wilderness. Where do Israel go after Egypt? They go to the wilderness. They spend how many years? 40 years in Israel, in Egypt. Where does Jesus spend his time? He spends his time in the wilderness for how many days? 40 days. So we see everything that happens in the Old Testament is only a symbol of what is going to happen in the New Testament. The whole Old Testament story is a story that will be played out in the life of Jesus in 33 years. Are you with me? They were scattered. Israel was scattered because they did not follow what God told them to do. God said, if you will not listen to me, I will scatter you on the face of the earth. And that's exactly what God did. He scattered them on the face of the earth. But just before Jesus came, what did he do? He brought them back. Just before Jesus, he brought them back. About 200 years before Jesus, he brought them from Iraq. He brought them from Babylon, Persia, wherever. And then they were settled there. And then who came? Jesus came. But by the time Jesus came, Jewish nation was a proud nation. There was a little story that took place of God saying to a prophet, go to the Syrians and give my message to them. Why? Because Israel was supposed to give the message of God all over the world. So God calls a prophet by the name of Jonah, says to him, go to Syria, give my message to them. And Jonah says, I'm not going. Why am I not going? Because they should not be saved. Because they're more sinners than we are. We are the good guys. We are the covenant people. We are the chosen race. How can God you save them? Are you with me? And then God still saves them. Jonah never preached a sermon, by the way. We think that he preached. No, he didn't. All he did was he stood in the middle of them and they said, what happened to you? Because you smell fishy. Are you with me? And then Jonah says, because I didn't want to come here, God put me in a fish, threw me over there, and now here I am. And they said, man, if this is what happened to him, he didn't preach a sermon. All they thought was, if this is what happened to him for rejecting the will of God, what's going to happen to us if we reject the will of God? So they just accepted. Are you with me? And was Jonah happy? No, Jonah was so angry with God. He says, why did you save them? You should not save them because they don't deserve to be saved because we are better than them. We are okay to be saved, but not them. They're bad. They're sinners. They're adulterers. They're terrorists, whatever. They shouldn't be saved. And then God saves them. Jewish nation always thought that the salvation was only for them, nobody else. Everybody else was Gentiles. Indians, Chinese, Africans, Europeans, Americans. They're not part of the covenant of God. It's only Israel. And then God brings Jesus. And Jesus is going to once and for all erase this image out of them. He's going to erase this image that God is only a God of one nation. Jesus will erase that image forever and ever. Never again will you have that image. And Jesus will speak a verse, John 3:16, that will change the course of time. And that will be a game changer. Game changer. What is God going to do? What is Jesus going to do? In John 3:16, it is the very hub of the gospel. One verse has the whole Bible in it. If you ever forget your Bible and forget every verse of the Bible, do not forget this verse because this is the very hub of the gospel. And also, it is the very vital center. In this verse is everything that you need to understand the love of God and the message of God. It is a part of divine revelation. What? This verse. And also, all the truths of Old Testament convey towards it. All the doctrines of the New Testament emerge from it. Okay? And all the high roads of ancient history, they make to it. And finally, all the divine prophecy, all the divine prophecy lead to John 3:16. Everything in the Bible is pointing to John 3:16. Old Testament points to it. New Testament doctrines point to it. Everything in the history points to it. Everything in the story of Abraham and Israel points to it. Are you with me? So John 3:16 is the center of the Old Testament and the New Testament. All truth emanates from it. All truth. So just as Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Pluto circle around the sun to receive illumination from it. You know, all that planetary things that revolve around it. So all the redemptive truth of redemption, riches of divine grace, forgiveness of sin, reconciliation, justification, eternal salvation, glorification, they all revolve around this statement of God's redeeming love that is found in John 3:16. Everything is there. Glorification, sanctification, salvation, reconciliation, and redemptive truth of redemption is right here. So what is John 3:16? John 3:16 tells us very clearly that the Bible is the greatest book on the face of this earth. There is no doubt about it. And it is the world's greatest seller. The Bible has how many? 66 books, 1189 chapters, 31,218 verses, 3,566,480 letters. And all the truth, great truth that is contained in John 3:16, it is still the gospel in the whole story. You don't need the whole Bible to understand. That verse gives you the whole story. And I'm going to share with you that story, because in John 3:16 is the greatest verse, the greatest text in the Bible. What is John 3:16? John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life." Now pick up the story from Abraham, where God says to him, "Take your son on the altar." And now God says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his son," not Abraham's son, "gave his son." It's the greatest verse ever. Let's look at it for a minute. God is the greatest giver. He's the greatest. He's the greatest giver. Everything in this verse you are going to see is greatest. Everything in this verse is greatest. How do we see that? Let's look at it. It says, "For God, the greatest lover." Are you with me? "So loved," the greatest decree. "The world," the greatest company. "That he gave," the greatest action ever. "His only son," the greatest gift. "That everyone," the greatest opportunity. "Who believes in him," who believes, the greatest simplicity. Just by believing, you can have everything. "Who believes," the greatest simplicity. "In him," which is the greatest attraction. "Would not perish," the greatest assurance. "But," the greatest difference. "Would have," the greatest promise. "Eternal life," the greatest blessing ever. Every single thing in this verse is the greatest. Everything is beyond measure. Unbelievable what this verse is telling us and showing us. So in other words, John 3:16 has some of the greatest words. Word number one, God. Word number two, loved. World, gave, his son. Whosoever believes, perish, life. All these are powerful words. Life is a great word. God is a great word. Whosoever is a great word. Gave is a great word. Every single word of this verse is so important. They are the greatest. The verse is the greatest. And God, of course, is the greatest. John 3:16 shows us a path. What is this path? The path is that on one side we have God and on the other side we have the Son. On one side we have love and on the other side we have gave. On one side we have world and on the other side we have whosoever. On one side we have believe and on the other side we have. In other words, what I'm saying to you is, on one side is perish and on the other side is life eternal. Every single thing in this verse is so important. We're on a path where God is going to show us the best of the best. So we're seeing here that God loves, God gives, and God saves. Why? We see that in the verse. "For God so loved," he loves, "he gives, and then he saves us so that we cannot perish." He has saved us. He loves us, He gives and then he also saves through that. Amazing what we see here in these verses, in this one verse itself. So then, let's now see, God's love is unique and unusual. It is unbelievable what we're seeing here, because we see one thing, that in this God's love, nobody can erase the love of God out of our hearts. Why? Because the mathematician cannot figure it out. The mathematicians cannot figure it out, the love of God. History cannot begin to tell you about his love. And also, geography cannot locate the depth of his love. Geometry cannot measure the heights of his love. Architect cannot lay the foundation of his love. Electrician cannot improve the light of his love. The animist cannot eat up his love. Water cannot drown his love. Fire cannot burn his love. Snow cannot cover his love. And I'm trying to tell you that ice cannot freeze his love. And I'm also saying that storms cannot blow his love. And I'm saying that death cannot take away his love. His love is so powerful and is so interesting for each and everyone. Rather, I should say, is so unique and so unusual that we can experience his love and it will not die. God shows his love. How? God shows his love because God is love. God shows his love because God sees love with his eyes. God feels love with his hands. And with his voice, he speaks love. With his feet, he walks love. And with his heart, he expresses love. This is God. Everything about God is love. And he has shown us one of the greatest opportunities ever of experiencing his love in Jesus. Tonight, I want to tell you, I don't know which background you're from tonight. I don't know how far away you've been from God. I do not know where you stand in the presence of God tonight. I do not even know if you are in love with God right now. Or are you like the prodigal son who's gone away, far away from God? But I want to give you the last and the most important verse for tonight. Romans 8 verse 35 that explains this. 35 to 39. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And tonight I want to say, for I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor height, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. No one can separate us from the love of God. Brothers and sisters, I want to give you the assurance tonight. He did not love you because you were doing some nice things. He doesn't love you because you're the nicest person ever. He doesn't love you because you are giving so much tithe that nobody has ever given. He's not loving you because you're coming to church all the time, so now you're a good person, so he's going to love you. He loved you even while you were sinners. He loves you not because you have loved him, but he first loved you. That is the beauty of this God. And this is why I cannot not love this God. I have to love this God because of what he has done for me and what he has done for you and what he continues to do for us. Thank you, Jesus, for what you have done. Thank you for exemplifying in a biggest way on that cross the love of God in a practical human way that I can understand. And you have saved me forever. And I can be part of the love of God. And I can enjoy the party of God one day when I get to heaven. What a great celebration that will be. When we are saved because we trusted him. Because whosoever believes in him shall be saved. Tonight, I'm going to be praying for you. But I know that you might be from different places. And as I pray for you, I'd like you to raise up your hand and say, God, I have been touched by this message, and I'm amazed by the love you have for me, and I want to offer myself into your hands tonight. God, I want to give myself to you. And even if it means a complete surrender, I am willing to do that. So raise up your hand as I pray. Father in heaven, Lord God, I want to thank you tonight for the great and wonderful things you've done in our life, each one of us. But Father, tonight we are here, gathered here, because we opened up your word and we tried to understand what your word is saying to us. And you are saying that you loved us so much that you gave your son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Father, there are some who are raising up their hand right now. They have understood your love, and they want to be in your love, and they want to be part of your love, and they want to exemplify this love to others as well. Father, they have come from different backgrounds. They have things in their own life they know have not been absolutely right, but they're offering themselves up completely in your hand and surrendering it all into your hands, because they know that their life will be meaningful when they live according to you, your precepts. Bless those whose hands are up right now. Heal them if they want to be healed. Protect them, bless them, keep them, and provide for them. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Shall we stand with our closing song?
quick announcement before we pray and close. As you're going out, there are packs that you can take with you if you need some more snacks. So please help yourself as we go out. I'm sure we're being blessed. I am blessed. Shall we pray? Lord, we lift our hearts and minds with joy and thanksgiving to you tonight for such a love that you have expressed to us, dying in our stead and giving us eternity, promise fulfilled. And so tonight, as we pass from here, Lord, may our hearts continue to go with this joy and assurance, waiting until your coming. We know there will be challenges, as it says in Romans chapter 8, but they are not sufficient to deter us from your love. They are not sufficient to detach us away from the love you had towards us. And so with this, we know, in summary, we are more than conquerors. May this joy and assurance continue to radiate and resonate in our hearts and mind as we go home tonight and as we live the rest of our days. In Jesus' name we pray. See you tomorrow.
Amen. Have you been blessed? Amen. I want to announce that if you want to pray, the elders are going to be here. Myself is going to be here. Pastor Petra is going to be here for a little while. He's not feeling too well, but he's going to make an effort to be here with us for a few more minutes. So if you need prayer, you need to talk to somebody, I'm going to be here. Pastor will be here. The elders will be here at the front. So feel free to come. Otherwise, be blessed, and I'll see you tomorrow. And I hope to see you tomorrow with a friend. God bless you. Good night.